Souls-like has become one of the most often used terms in gaming over the past decade. I genuinely lost track of the number of times I heard it used to describe a new game at E3 this past month. And honestly, I kinda get it. From Software's winning formula has spent the past decade changing the DNA of the action-adventure genre as a whole. Its tough but fair approach to difficulty truly embodies the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. But to me, the thing that makes Souls games so memorable isn't the steep difficulty, nebulous mechanics, or grotesque bosses. Although don't get me wrong, I love all of those dearly. No, to me, the thing that makes From Software's games truly tick is a pure sense of adventure, exploration, and discovery that feels like it pulls directly from iconic games like Nintendo's Legend of Zelda series. A lot of games imitate, but few are truly able to understand their inspirations. And so, it's fitting that E3 saw a pair of standout upcoming indie games in Tunic and Death's Door that take the special parts of the Zelda-like and Souls-like and manage to marry the philosophies into a wonderful union. Tunic is a game that's been on our indie radars for the past several years, and it's pretty easy to understand why. This thing is absolutely stunning. Playing Tunic feels like you're peeking into a Lilliputian world. Everything has a handcrafted, diorama look to it, much like 2019's remake of Link's Awakening. But don't let this charming veneer fool you. The world of Tunic is a dangerous one, and a wrong move could mean curtains for your cute little critter. The things you're doing in Tunic should feel immediately familiar. Roll through tall grass, tramp through dark caves, and slash your way through enemies, all in the name of wonderful unknown treasure. But what makes Tunic so captivating is in how its own gorgeous world and strange mysteries act as the carrot at the end of its stick. As I pressed on through the dangerous hills and deep caverns, inevitably succumbing to some manner of beast, I kept finding a new and alluring bit of the game that had me happily trudging back from the nearest save point. Much like the Souls games, there's a satisfying risk-reward decision that comes with every single bonfire-like place of safety. Do you take a moment to rest, cash in your hard-earned experience, and refill your life-saving Estus flasks, knowing that this means that all the enemies you worked so hard to vanquish will be brought back to life? Or do you roll the dice and press on, trying to make it to the next mile marker and hope that something doesn't come along and extinguish your flame? And so, if Tunic feels like you're looking into a toy box, then Death's Door is more akin to taking a quick peek into hell. But like a quaint version of hell, the kind of hell where the job of the Reaper is filled with grim Fandango-esque bureaucracy, and where the influences of classic films like Spirited Away are worn as a badge of honor. That kind of hell. I won't spoil any of the neat story reveals, but like Tunic, Death's Door has you exploring dungeons, solving puzzles, and growing your own arsenal as you prepare for an inevitable fight with some towering boss. You gain combat abilities such as this neat fireball, which also doubles as a tool to solve environmental puzzles. This lends additional weight and importance to each new skill you earn. One of the standout mechanics in Death's Door comes from its health system. Deliberately spaced throughout the world are various pots filled with soil. If you plant a seed into them, it'll immediately grow into a bud that replenishes your health. The thing is, you can only use the plant once per each run. They grow back if you die, or if you head back into the hub world to upgrade your stats, but of course that means that the enemies will come back as well. The interesting tweak here is that there's only a finite number of seeds, and most are hidden across the map. Scouring the world for these seeds, strategically planning on where to plant them, and making sure that I had at least one saved up to plant close to a boss chamber created a wonderful metagame inside the world of Death's Door. A thing that both games share is that their worlds are not procedurally generated or randomized. While this might cut down on replayability in the long run, the bespoke nature of each area and encounter give both games a real sense of place. Throughout each demo, I was constantly curious to pull at various threads of the story, the world, and the lore behind it all. For me, being able to learn exactly what waits behind a door makes the concept of mastery feel attainable, even after a dozen or so deaths at the hands of a particularly nasty creature. In both games, individual enemy patterns are simple enough to learn, but remain a threat when paired with a handful of other dangers. This gave me a sense of control over the chaos that led to some really rewarding moments of triumph. Finally, the way both games play with depth, framing, and your own vantage point adds equal amounts of tension to the combat, as well as a great sense of wonder to the exploration. I love how in Tunic, reaching specific vantage points allow you to zoom the camera out and survey a wide swath of the land. Discovering new areas that lay tantalizingly out of reach until you unearth some new ability, or perhaps stumble upon them after taking the long way around. While we've seen plenty of Zelda-likes and Souls-likes over the years, few games have managed to understand the exact elements that make them great, quite like Tunic and Death's Door. And so, while we wait for Elden Ring and the sequel to Breath of the Wild to come along next year, fingers crossed on that one, it's indies like these that seem to be adeptly carrying their torch. Both games will be hitting PC and the Xbox family of consoles soon, with Death's Door coming in July and Tunic arriving later this year. For more on both, stick right here on The Escapist.